Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Understanding God's Loving Laws group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Human Will and Desire Principles question and answer presentation, Jesus answers questions from the audience about the material covered in the previous presentations, Human Will Principles and Human Desire Principles. Recorded on the 11th of November, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
So this presentation is Human Will and Desire Principles Q&A. And as I just stated, there are quite a lot of questions. Human Will and Desire Principles, question and answers. Let's get started. If we start with Natalie, where are you, Natalie? Over there, thanks. One mic there. And the second one, could we go to Diana? Where are you, Diana? Over there. So, Diana next. Fire away, Natalie.
You want my first question?
Well, yes, your first question. Okay.
I thought my soul and the errors I've absorbed drove my thoughts, beliefs, attitudes and actions, etc. Can you clarify how it is my will that does this?
Well, yes, the answer to this question is you're confusing. You're talking about exactly the same thing here. So the soul and the errors you've absorbed, along with its proper condition as well, because it also could have absorbed some truths, right?
Yep.
So you're just assuming it's all error, but it's not. Actually does determine your thoughts, beliefs and actions. And that is your will. That is your will.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
So we need to start seeing that as our current state. Remember when we talked about will, and I might just pop to the definition here. It's the genuine expression of the gift of free will. That's human will. But in terms of here we go, is determined by the current soul-based emotional condition. So what you're saying is exactly what this is saying.
Okay.
You follow?
Yeah. I was kind of viewing it like they were two separate things and they're not.
No.
Is that because like God gave us the gift of free will and that's in our soul?
Well, free will, remember, was different in definition. Remember we went back to the free will definition. That's the God-given gift of the ability to be a self-aware being.
Okay.
That's a gift given by God. There's a completely definition between that and the way in which we define will, which is our current what we want to do right now.
Okay.
inside of our feelings. Does that make sense?
Yes.
In other words, it's how our will is developed right at this one moment in time.
Okay.
Right.
Thanks.
Yep. So we need to make sure that of that distinction. Diana, thank you. You might have more than one, but it was just one question. Yep.
The will principles.
Yep. Yes. I've got it on the desire principles.
Oh,
as well.
I've got that one. Yep.
You got that one?
Yep.
Yep. Fire away with that one.
I can see that if will and desire are aligned in, for an example, refusal to change, then change is not possible. But when a desire is felt and will is developed towards attaining the desire, how are they not in harmony when the desire is actually met?
Yeah, this demonstrates some basic misunderstandings on your part. Will is not developed towards attaining the desire. Remember, will is your current condition. It has no concept of its future. You follow me?
Yeah.
It only has a concept of your current place, where you are right at this moment, right?
Yep.
Hasn't got any idea about the future. Desire is the thing that has the idea about the future. The faith about the future. So what you're doing is you're mixing the two up. Now, will and desire, when we talked about will in the first assistance group, we were merging the two principles of will and desire. And we started to introduce you to the concept of aspiration as a part of your will. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But what we're suggesting in these principles is that God actually has two separate principles. One principle is whatever your current condition is right now, the laws will respond to, and whatever your desire is right now, the laws will respond to. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And your will and desire, if they're identical, obviously the laws will respond identically. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But if your will and desire are different, it will respond one way to your will and another way to your desire.
Yeah, thanks. So
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. I'm sort of now starting to understand why I feel like I've got to drive my will to, you know, develop this desire or something.
You can't drive your will to do anything.
No.
How does your will change? It's by having a desire and the desire pulling the will into a new condition. Yeah. That's how will changes.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So let's say your will is here at this point in time, and this is where you'd like your will to be in the future. Desire is the thing that causes you to have faith that this is possible. Without that faith, you will not do anything, because your will is here. And if there's no faith, there is no desire. And if there's no desire, you will not change. You will not do something about the current state. You will remain in it. Does that make sense to everyone? So it's very important for you to see that desire is the very thing we talked about in the first group, faith, the importance of faith. That's what is desire. That's what drives you into doing something. Does that make sense? Yeah, so it's very important to see that distinction. So what we're suggesting is our current development is here. That's where our will is currently. And will has no concept. So the will principles have no concept of what you hope for your future. Does that make sense to everyone? They only process what you are right now. That's all the will principles do. They only process what you are right now, right? It's the desire that causes you to imagine what is possible for your future, but not only imagine it, believe that it is possible to obtain. That's what desire does. And desire principles, if we look at desire principles from God's perspective, God also has laws that respond to that. And the laws that respond to will, the laws also respond to desire. And unless your will and desire are completely different from each other in some way, no change is actually possible, because you don't have any faith in a future developed condition. Yep. It's a very important thing to grasp this. So if we go to Mary, thank you. And then I would like to have where's Carol? If we can have the mic with Carol next.
It was just to mention that even when we're in a condition, say we're at one with God, that's our will. We're self-responsible, totally self-responsible. But unless we have a desire, we'll never get to the ninth sphere. Do you see that? So it's not just in this negative sense that we're talking about. Yeah. Okay.
Everyone get that? A few ahas there. You get that? You can see why. Like, so when Mary and I, when I on earth in the first century reached the ninth sphere, I had to desire to get to the 10th and desire to get to the 11th. Does that make sense? Don't think that desire, this is the beauty of will and desire, is they are constantly changing. Don't think that desire is going to change after you've got somewhere. Like, it's not like that. It's like a lot of people have the viewpoint of like 1 minute is like Sydney. And me going to Sydney means I strive, get to Sydney, and then I'm done. Don't need to do anything more. It's not like that at all, because you have other desires which you then start to have some faith in, and off you go, going further than that. And the reality is, you know, let's say you become at one with God. Now, normally what happens when people become at one with God, they're overwhelmed by the experience. But because they have already developed this principle, they know this principle of desire, they know that it's not going to stop there. And they have faith that it doesn't stop there by that stage. But imagine for a moment that that wasn't true. if you only had faith in the at-one-ment condition and you developed desire obviously desire would be developed because the faith exists, so you would go to the at-one-ment condition. But now that you're at the at-one-ment condition, what's going to happen? Unless there's a desire for something else, you will stagnate. You will stay where you are. And it's the same with the rest of your existence. If your desire matches your will, you will stay where you are. So there's many people who arrive in that condition, and for the first instance, you can imagine that they're very overwhelmed by it and so forth, so there's a lot of learning that takes place, but they don't go, oh, well, I'm here now, so I'm going to stop that. They don't do that, because they've already learnt the principle from their life up until that point, so they continue exercising further desires that are beyond that condition. That makes sense, doesn't it? But if they didn't, then the eighth sphere would be it for them. Make sense? Yeah. Okay, Carol.
If I have a desire to change based on getting away from pain, will that help me change while I'm developing faith and love for God and God's laws?
Very good question. And very interesting, because this is something almost all of you believe. If you have a desire to change based on getting away from pain, you will never change. And you know why? Because your faith has not been developed to change. You've got to have a belief in you that you can actually avoid pain by engaging some other things before you will have a desire or faith in that, right? So what I observe many of you doing, and many of you have attended Divine Truth sessions for many years in this mode, you're only coming to get away from pain, right? But the actual emotion, the desire, the faith that it is possible to get away from pain doesn't exist in you. And it certainly doesn't exist in you that it's done by feeling your emotions. That doesn't exist in you yet. And so you do not feel your emotions, and so there's no desire to feel your emotions, and so no change is possible. So even though you're in pain in this state, no change is possible. Isn't that interesting? Now, it's a very interesting concept for many of you to grasp, that actually no change, if you're just here to get away from pain, you will not have faith that you're able to. You have to develop faith that you're able to get away from pain before you will that will even motivate you. Does that make sense to you? And many of you do not have faith that you can. Many of you are really strongly associated with the human flawed condition. In other words, you believe humanity is flawed and that's how we've been created, and there's no chance of that changing. And many of you have that belief very deeply inside of you as your current faith. Given that to be your current faith, do you think you're ever going to feel pain? Do you think you're going to ever feel the emotions that cause pain? No, you're not. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So this is why getting away from pain is, from God's perspective, not a very worthwhile motivation. Interesting, huh? Yes. You can, of course, willpower yourself around that. But we've also already talked about that in the discussion. If we can go to Igor next, and Inga next. So Inga down there and Igor first.
I haven't got it written down, but what is the inception of desire? For example, as we're kids, you know, we have certain desires, and as we reach puberty, there's a change in desires.
Yeah.
And if our character and nature has influence in our desires.
Yes. It's a very good question. So what principles or laws influence the inception of desire? The reality is that God has placed inside of us a number of instinctual things that can help generate a desire. So, for example, the instinct to know, right? You notice that in a child, where very undeveloped a child may be, but one of the first things they start doing is going, why is that? Why daddy? Why daddy? Why mummy? Why does this happen? Why does that happen? Shut up, kid. You know, that's where you shut it down, right? But because I told you so, but you know, this is where it normally goes. But why did this instinctual desire to know the truth is actually something that has been inbuilt in us. So God has actually done a number of things to encourage you to have desire as well. And some of those desires are driven by different sensations that appear in the body. However, the soul has control over the body. And unfortunately on this planet, most of us don't believe that. Most of us believe the body is what controls us. So therefore, the body has some natural instinctual parts to it too that are separate to the soul's instinct. Do you understand what I mean? And in the pageant messages, we refer to that as the animal side of your nature. The human body is very, very similar in its nature and very similar in the laws that govern it to a mammal, any other mammal. Right? But see, the trouble is many of you think that those laws that govern the body supersede the laws of the higher creation of the soul. So if we examine it this way, you've got your physical body, right? And remember, overcloaking your physical body is your spirit body, but I'll draw it like this. Here's your spirit body, and here's your soul, right? Many of you believe that your sexual motivations come from the physical body's development, right? Now, that is true for a mammal, but it's not true for something that has a higher creation with a higher set of laws. This is the thing that determines these things, not the other way around, right? So in the soul of a person who is connected with God, their sexual desires do not drive them from the physical level. The sexual desire that occurred in the soul drives them. So they are only interested in a sexual interaction with their other half. That's all they're interested in. They're not interested in sexually and interested in anyone else. Can you see the difference? Whereas a mammal is driven only by the body's and the spirit body's desires. So therefore, it responds no matter what, right? And then what do we do with that? We go, oh, well, the animals do it, you know, like, so we should do it. But we're forgetting that this is a higher creature with higher laws governing it. And if you connect to it and you're aware of it, then this thing determines your sexual response, not any other way, you see? So don't mistake... Don't make comparisons of lower creations with higher creations. It's a major flaw we have in the way in which we examine scientific truth on the planet. Animals, mammals, are lower creations. They are not governed by exactly the same things that we are governed by from the soul level, because they don't have a soul. They are only their physical body and spirit body. That's all they are. That has a number of laws and instinctual laws governing it. But the soul, the human soul, is completely different to that. It governs the bodies. So for this person to have sex with anyone, the soul has to have an issue. But for an animal to have sex with any other animal of the same species, it doesn't have to have an issue. Can you see the difference? And this is why we need to stop the comparison. But yes, we are, in answer to Igor's question, we do have many instincts inbuilt into the soul. There is an instinct to know in this soul that drives our desire, that drives other things, including our desire. Yep. And you'll also notice that a child by nature is quite trusting in comparison to an adult. They don't trust per se, But what they do is they are trusting of answers given to them. They're open to answers given to them, whereas adults become very resistive to answers given them. So there is also inbuilt in the soul, right at its inception, there was inbuilt this desire to know and an openness to understand, which then gets suppressed throughout our existence generally. But it's there. And that's another thing that causes us to grow and change, these instinctual things that have been built into the soul. So God has enabled, and there are many hundreds or thousands of ways God's enabled you to work out that desire is great, right? And therefore enabled a way of you learning about desire and engaging it and then measuring its results. Yeah? I want to keep going with these ones. We're up to Inga. Thank you.
Is it the first one or second?
First one first, and we'll do both of yours, actually.
Okay. Yep. Could giving up and not engaging any desire in a loving way, like feed a person with unloving desires and intentions, like a dictator, in the same way as giving up your will could?
You certainly can give up desires. Yeah. Certainly you can, and that can certainly, you can allow other people to influence your desires, certainly. But there must be some reason why you would, right?
Yeah.
Usually there is a reason. And for most of us, that reason is fear. Fear is the primary reason why we give up desires. Yeah. So we need to understand that. I like the second part of your question, though, which you didn't read. It says, do we contribute to the bad state of the world if we don't find out and really engage our desire in a loving way? Yes, we do.
Yeah.
By not having desires, we are basically passive. Also, by not having desires, as we've explained, our will remain unchanged. So if our will is already sinful in the fact that we've gathered together a lot of sin or collected a lot of sin over our life, and therefore our will is quite set and we have no desire, then of course our will is contributing to the condition of the world exactly as it is now. So yes, those questions are valid questions, but they are all demonstrating that if we don't have desires, then it's highly likely we are going to be participating in the condition of the world as it is right now.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. Because remember, the natural human condition is to agree with the world's definition of love. So I grow up in a world that has a certain definition of love. Of course, by the time I'm an adult, my will is very set in that belief system of that condition. And of course, it varies from society to society and nation to nation and family to family. But whatever that environment has imposed upon me, it's highly likely my will will be set as an adult by that stage. Now, what's going to change me? Nothing else other than the desire to be different to that. Nothing else. And a desire means that I need to have some faith that I can be different to that. Most people don't even consider that their entire life on earth. They don't have any faith that they can change. Yeah. Your next question?
I have to change it. Why are a lot of people so resistant to letting their sons and daughters develop their own desires and go their own way?
Yeah, very good question,
why?
Isn't it?
Yeah.
This is one of the major influences, emotional influences on a child to not have desire, is when the child realizes that its desire is out of harmony with the desire of its environment, and usually under those circumstances, the child's desire is punished because it is out of harmony with the desires of the environment, the child learns to suppress desire. And this is the case for many of you. Many of you have learnt now to severely suppress desire, severely suppress what you would really like. And as a result of that, it's very, very difficult for you now to even develop a desire because you're so afraid that if you develop a desire, the world around you will punish it. And while it is true, the world around us does punish it, God does not. God rewards it. So we need to start seeing, well, who's got more control over the laws? Probably God, right? So it's probably in our best interest if we examine one of the first things we need to examine is our faith in the fact that God is good and that God will reward desire in harmony with love. That's one of the first faiths that we really need to develop if we're going to change. But there are many emotional reasons why parents develop this control of their children, many of which relate to the parents having their worth involved in the children's life and their concept of themselves being explained through explored through the children. Many times for mothers, it's like, I'm a mother now. And there is this deep, unhealed process for all mothers in humanity of believing that they need a child to validate their worth as a woman. And there are many other reasons why this happens, like literally thousands of emotional reasons why it might happen. The key for us, if we've been affected by it, is to start developing our desire so we don't care about what our family thinks about us changing and we actually engage change still. That's going to be a key part. And in fact, for many of you, you've yet to go through that phase with divine truth. In other words, you're still pandering to family, still not really changing yourself, so you're still fitting into their concept of what you should be. And this is an indication that you've not given up that fear that is suppressing your desire to be closer to God at any time in the future. Yeah. And you'll notice that almost anybody, and I would suggest to you that at this stage, everybody who engages the principles of divine truth in their life personally will end up in conflict with their family of origin. Now, that is only not possible if all the family of origin are also engaging the principles of God's truth. And the likelihood of that happening at the beginning is very low, right? So everybody will go through this family of origin conflict. Now, one reason why we're going through it is because God's trying to teach us that actually they, the so-called family that you have, are not your family. From God's perspective, we're all brothers and sisters, and so 7 billion people on earth are your family. You've got a fairly large extended family. God's a pretty productive father and mother. Pretty busy he's been, right? So you got a lot of brothers and sisters. And you need to come to terms with that emotionally. Many of you have not. You still have this feeling about family that you're longing for or holding on to, and that is severely stopping in many cases you having a desire. Yeah. That's good questions.
Okay, thank you.
Felix, could we go to Felix? Your first question, Felix.
Sorry, which one was?
Well, it starts, do God's laws. Jesus' laws. Put responding to my desire before responding to my will.
Do God's laws put responding to desire before responding to will? What does that mean in practice? And could you please give some examples? I thought yes when I listened to you.
No.
Oh, okay.
No, the answer is no, sorry. Okay. There you go. Does God hold one principle, the principle of desire, over the principle of will? The answer is no. God treats them as equally important because the laws respond equally to them, right? So the principle of will and the principle of desire are responded to equally. So you will be in this position many times in your future until you're at one with God, you'll be in a position like this. You start developing a faith-based desire to change something, but the law of attraction is still bringing you what you currently are, right? At the same time as the law of attraction also bringing you what you currently desire.
Oh, okay.
So you get this mixture occurring, right? And it's treated equally. So this mixture occurs where on one hand you're getting some stuff inside of you that's showing you, yeah, this is out of harmony with love. That's the law of attraction operating upon will. And then on the other hand you get these wonderful things happening just because you had a desire. That's all. Only reason why. And you haven't yet changed your will on that thing, but the desire is bringing you these wonderful things.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So God's laws treat them equally, with human will and human desire. And this is great because it means that you can actually receive good things even though you haven't changed yet. Imagine if you had to do all the changing before you received anything good. Yeah. And when I say haven't changed yet, I mean that your will hasn't changed yet. All we need to do to bring positive things in our life is to change desire first, and then positive things will start appearing to help us draw the will to that position. Yeah.
May I ask another question about
that? No, can I go on?
Okay.
Thanks. Raj, number... Raj, thank you. And if we can go back to Nat again. Where's Nat? Thank you. All right.
It was a simple question.
It's a very simple question. Fire away.
Oh, sorry.
You got to stand though.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Where did my desire go?
Yeah. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. You remember that song? Where did my desire go? Long time passing. Isn't it a long time ago since many of you actually experienced a pure desire? You got to wonder, where did it go? What happened to it? And this is a very good question, actually, because it illustrates that many of our desires have been suppressed through many means. Now, maybe we should examine some of the means through which desire is suppressed. Let's look at the primary one. What do you think the primary one will be? Ah, that's not parents, huh? It's fear. Is the primary way in which your desire gets suppressed. Fear is the false appearing real. Now remember, faith is having a desire, is having a faith. This is saying, I have faith in nothing that is true. I only have faith in the things that are false, appearing true. Does that make sense? That's what fear is it not?
Yes.
Faith in the false. Faith in the false being real. That's what fear is. If you examine, like, why are you afraid of a spider? Because you're afraid of what it might do to you, even though it's a tiny little thing you could squash at the moment. No, like, you're still afraid. What about a snake and all the other things you're afraid of physically? Isn't it the same thing? You're really just afraid and you don't really know why, right? It's the false appearing real to you, the false expectation appearing real. So this is saying, I believe in false. What's false? So there's the primary reason why there's no desire. I believe in what is false. Now, where that belief come from, it could have come from parents, it could have come from society, it could have come from your schooling, it could have come from some of your own experiences in life that have fed that back to you because of not having the concept that God is good and things like that. It can come from a multitude of sources. But it is the problem. So don't think your parents are the problem and don't think your childhood's the problem. Everyone's had some kind of a negative thing occur in their childhood and everyone's got some parents that didn't know what they're doing, right? And let's face it, most of us who have been parents still didn't know what we're doing when we're adults. So everyone's got that. That's not what suppresses desire. It's the actual fear that we let fester and stay within us that causes it. Now, fear, as we learnt in our previous group, drives what other group thinks.
Oh, addictions, right.
Addictions, does it not? So addictions are a layer over your fear.
Right.
Right? A layer over your fear is going to remove you twice. You're now twice removed.
From the desire.
From desire. Can you see?
Yep.
You're now further removing yourself. And if you go into the next thing above addictions, which is, remember we learnt that last time, now you're three times removed.
Right.
You see, and the more you do...
You build a wall.
You just finish up building a wall and say, where did my desire go? Well, it's buried. It's buried under your denial and your addictions.
Right.
That's where it is.
Thank you.
So it's still there. It still can be developed. You can still do something about developing it, but you're going to first have to what?
Remove the denial.
Remove the denial and remove the addictions. Right. And then you'll start seeing some of your fears.
Right. Surrounding.
And once you start releasing your fears, desire, you start feeling, oh, maybe I can do some other things, right? Desires will start becoming, you'll become aware of desire again.
That's great, thank you.
Yeah, it's fantastic. But that's the problem if we have that issue.
The light hasn't gone out.
Sorry, well...
It's just
God made your soul so the light can't go out. You know, remember we said in the permanence principle, God created your soul so that it can't be destroyed as far as we're aware. So no one has ever had a destroyed soul. So that tells me that something, there must be a spark in there. But I don't know if you've read the Paget messages much, but in their Paget messages, there's one guy that said, I've lost my soul. Where has it gone? I don't know. And what he really meant was he's lost his desire. He doesn't know where it's all gone. And what it is is buried under a whole series of mud that eventually means the light of your soul is so suppressed it's like covered over, covered over, covered over. It's like a ball of light being covered over and dipped in mud every day, drying out, dipped in another layer of mud, drying out. Eventually it would have so much mud around it that you can't even see it's a light anymore, right? And that's what it is for most of us. Natalie, thanks.
Is this a desires question, Paige?
This is if desire is...
If desire is driven by what my soul has faith in, if I don't have faith in something, example, that I can't change or be a better person, does that mean that I can't desire and therefore can't then use my will to change?
Correct.
Does this then relate to the false beliefs layer you discussed in the drawing of the previous assistance group?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so quite simple answer is that basically what we're saying, in Natalie's question is asking, are you saying that if I don't have faith, that it's impossible for me to change? And it's impossible for me to even have, to develop a desire to change? And I'm saying, yes, faith is desire. So if faith is desire and desire is faith, can you see if you don't have faith, you're stuffed?
Yes.
Don't
yes.
you?
Yeah.
Like, you can see the importance of starting to see the difference of trying to actually have some faith.
Yes.
Working through why you don't have faith. Even just the question, why don't I have faith? Now I've shifted from my will. My will before then was, I don't care if I don't have faith. Right? I believe I shouldn't have faith. And me just going, why don't I have faith? Could I have faith? Is it an immediately a potential for change? Because I've now moved my desire from believing what the will is currently to having a new position. Even just the question.
Yeah,
and this is why God built inside of you the instinct to ask questions. And this is what many of you do when you're at the groups, you don't ask questions. Why do you think I love responding to questions? Because I know it's the way for you to generate desire. Yeah.
Thank you.
Of course, many of your questions are driven by this thing, right? Which is actually this, and of course not going to result in much action if that's the case, right? A child doesn't ask questions based on fear generally. A child asks questions because of the inquisitive nature of the child, wanting to understand for no other reason than wanting to understand. It's not driven by a negative emotion to do that. Yeah. Glenn, where's going down here? And Yvonne. Yvonne's on this side. Who's on this side? Is Melinda on this side? She on that side too. Just let me see. That's right. I've got Shula, your last question. Where's Shula? Is she on that side too? No, she's here. So Shula, if we can have a mic with you. And it's the one that you wrote down in the break, in the lunch break. Yeah. Okay, Glenn, fire away.
I'm going to say you answered a fair bit of this one.
I have.
I think there's more, but you've answered a lot. How can we get our desires in harmony with what God wants for us?
Well, this is a very problematic question on a lot of levels, actually, Glenn. Yep. What does God desire for you?
What I want.
He desires for you to have desires.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, it's like asking sort of a double-ended question, isn't it, here? He desires you to have desires, but what kind of desires does he desire you to have?
Ones in harmony with his law.
But why does he desire that?
So we all have a nice place to live.
And so you're happy.
Yeah.
He wants you happy.
Yeah.
So he wants you to experience happiness. Yeah. He wants you to experience, now I'm just trying to find your question. Where did I put it? It's the last page, was it? Ah, sorry, it is, sorry.
Yeah.
My girl's got track of me. So how do I get my desire in harmony with what God wants for me? Well, God wants you just to have desires in harmony with love. That's all he wants. But you're asking for what specific desires does God want me to have? And now we're out of harmony with that, you see.
Yep.
Because he doesn't want you to have specific desires. This is the gift of free will. You can have any desire you want in harmony with love. That gives you billions and billions and billions and billions of possibilities for your desires.
Yeah.
Yeah. So why do you want to be told from God what your desire should be? Is my question.
Yep. That did dawn on me when you put the two circles up. And
why do we want to be told?
Because I don't want to.
You don't want to work it out for yourself.
I don't want to work it out.
Yeah, and this is the projection you have of the world around you.
Yes.
Not wanting to work out things for yourself.
Yes.
And as a result, you're giving away your will, giving away your desires. Yes. So what are your desires and will going to be governed by? Other people's desires for you.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Very bad bad practice to get into.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep.
Good idea. Yvonne, what's next? Thanks, Yvonne. And Shula will be after Yvonne, so... So I just want to do it in.
Is that what creates the need to be inspired continuously?
Yes. Good question. What creates the need to be inspired continuously is quite simple. Can you see it's almost the same as Glenn's question?
Yeah, lack of desire.
A lack of desire to be self-responsible.
Yeah.
You want others to be responsible for you.
Yeah.
So you lack desire even to have your own desires. You want other people to just tell you what to do, to inspire you, to tell you what to do. So can you see being driven by inspiration is actually, in a lot of ways, quite a negative thing for your soul? Can you see that? Because while you're driven by somebody else's inspiring discussions, you frequently do not do anything about them because there's nothing inside of you saying, oh, I want to do that. And this is where there's a lot of shift that has to occur to people hearing divine truth, because at the moment they're still reliant on inspiration, but there's still no aspiration to do it. So that tells me that desire, they're not coming face to face with desire. What are their real desires at the moment? Obviously, their real desire is to not do it, which probably matches the will, which is, I don't want to do it, right? Or which is, I'm scared of something, isn't it? Like scared of emotion, scared of overwhelming emotion and so forth. So we need to relook at the second group if we are in this condition where we constantly need inspiration. That's because we've yet to develop an aspiration to change, grow or be close to God.
So it's a bit like an addiction and it actually stops you from developing desire.
Yes,
or
it does. And it also gives power
to
others.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, it exposes you to gurus.
Mm.
And you think about your past life before you met me.
Yeah, 20 That's years.
20 years of it, right?
Yeah.
Of gurus and stuff. Yeah, so that's what exposed you to it, wanting to be inspired all the time, not having the aspiration coming from within oneself to change.
And not wanting to take self-responsibility underneath that.
Yes, yep. Wanting someone else to do that for you. So it's reliant on somebody else's energy, actually.
Mm.
It's actually a sucking thing. Can you see that? It's like, I want you to supply my power for me.
Mm.
You know, a person who's in a state of desire doesn't do that.
Actually, that's what Tony Robbins does in his business, is key directly to do that.
Yes.
So that people want to keep coming back for more.
Most gurus on the planet are getting power from spirits. And then they supply that power to any person that comes along. And because most people who come along are in addiction, they will pay that guru a lot of things, money, homage, respect, and a lot of other emotions in order to continue getting that power from them. But none of that benefits the person themselves because they've not yet developed the desire. So what's happening is they're still living in harmony just with will principles, and the desire principles are basically, they're identical to their will principles. So what happens? What have you noticed all the Tony Robbins followers in the end?
No change.
After 20 years, have they changed?
No.
No, they haven't. Of course not. They can't, because they're getting their...
They're getting their addictions met. And they're relying on, and they're giving their will to somebody else.
So addictions met is here?
Yes.
Which is two layers
removed
from your
my own desires.
From desire.
Mm, thank you very much.
That's what's happening. Yeah. Good question, though. Melinda was next to you. Just your question number two, Melinda, is one I'd like to address. You're still waiting, but I'll get there. I've got time.
Are most human instinctual needs based on addictions?
Yes, let's look at this whole concept. I think I partially answered that already, haven't I? If you remember the drawing of the soul and then the two bodies, right? So you've got physical body, spirit body, soul. Now, when you say human instinctual needs, we've got to now be quite specific, don't we? Because is a need of the body actually a human instinctual need?
Yeah, I got lost on the definition of desire in that last three words.
Instinctual stuff. So let's look at it. As many have commented, the human instinctual need is not the need of the physical body. That's the physical body's instinctual need. And remember, the human soul is governs the bodies. So it's not a human instinctual need. So you know how people say, oh, we all have a desire, a need for affection. We all have a need to be loved. We all have a need to have sex. We all have a need to eat. Well, almost all of those things are things that a person needs in their physical form. So therefore, are they really instinctual needs of the soul? Probably not, right?
Do we have a need to be safe, like a physical, or is that just an addiction, or can it be both?
It can be both, but the reality is that the soul is automatically safe.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
So the need to be safe is an injury, because it is not recognising that you're already safe. Do you follow that?
I do. I've just been learning little bits and pieces over the last couple of days about how loving God is. We're already safe.
Already safe, yeah. Now, if I'm already safe and I'm just not aware of it,
yeah,
that will create a need to be safe.
Yes, that's
me. So that's an addiction, isn't it? Based upon a fear. A fear is that I'm not already safe, and the addiction is I want to feel safe, so I do what makes me feel safe. But none of that is an instinctual need of the human body. Or the spirit body, for that matter, and nor is it instinctual need of the soul, because the soul is already safe.
Yeah.
So it doesn't need to have that. It's already there. Do you follow?
I do.
And in fact, God created this soul to not need anything. But He did create the soul with instincts, such as the instinct to desire truth. The instinct to desire development, the instinct to grow. These are instincts, many of which are governed by principles you've already seen.
So I have an instinct to grow.
You do. At the soul level, you do. Physically, you don't, and at the moment, you don't, because your will is exercised opposing growth.
Yeah.
But why is your will exercised opposing growth? Because of all these childhood events and other traumas, whatever else had happened. But the other problem is that your desire is not exercise to grow.
Yeah.
Why did that happen? Well, that's your fault.
It is my fault. I've only just learnt that.
Yeah.
A difference between will. I've been working to develop my will when really I have given no consideration to desire.
Correct.
I've always known, well, more recently I've known I haven't desired truth.
Yes.
So I've been working on my will to get to want to know truth. So yes. I've just been...
You can't work on your will for that. You've got to work on your desire for that.
Yeah, I've learned that 2 days ago. Thank you.
Exactly. So it's a good question though, isn't it? Because you can see that the instinctual parts of what we often refer to as the human body's instinct is not actually the instinct of the soul. The human body does have instincts. So the instinct to eat, the instinct to breathe, the instinct... it has specific needs. The human body does, but the soul does not. So the human body needs oxygen to survive. That is an instinct of the body, not the instinct of the soul. The soul can survive without oxygen.
Yep. Thank you. Yep.
So don't confuse the instinct requirements of the physical or spirit bodies with the soul's actual needs. And what I see is many people confusing those things. Remember, the physical body and the spirit body are, the physical body is the highest of the physical creations on the earth, in the physical universe, but it is not the soul. And the spirit body is the highest of the spirit-based or metaphysical-based creations in the spirit world, but it is not the soul. And the soul, being higher, a higher creation, governs these things. So if this has an instinct, this has the capacity to overcome the instincts, given the fact that it's a higher creation existing in a higher universe. So we start getting into complex ideas, but the reality is this soul has the ability to actually control every single physiological and sexual and psychological function in this physical body of yours. It has that capacity. You just don't believe it does, and so you let the physical body govern your soul. And that's letting a physical creation of a lower form govern a higher creation, which is directly out of harmony with
God's
hierarchy,
laws.
Hierarchy and governance.
Of law, yeah.
Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yep. Thank you.
Yep. Good question there. Shula, we're coming back to you. Just let me find you. I've lost Shula. Where is she gone? That's all done. That's done. That's done. I'll just put those away for a moment. That's a good question too, and that's a good question. Here we go. Am I going time-wise? 10, 11 minutes. See how we go.
If we choose to do nothing, does our soul automatically degrade?
Well, choosing to do nothing is having faith in doing nothing, is it not? Now, if your current will is that you're doing nothing and you have faith in doing nothing, then probably your soul is going to be just in the same place it's always been. That makes sense?
Yeah.
Yep. But if you have faith that you want to do nothing, even, or you've decided that, and besides, it was very hard, as you know, to do nothing, isn't it? Like,
yeah.
The body has dictates, you know, it needs to eat, so you've got to have some meals, and then if you've got to have some meals, it's hard to do nothing there because you've got to prepare them, or somebody's got to prepare them for you, and it's pretty hard to get other people to do it when they don't want to do it, so you're probably going to have to do that. So can you see actually doing nothing is pretty much a physical impossibility?
Yeah.
Right. So if we desire, if our current will is that we're doing something and we desire to do nothing, then of course our soul condition will degrade. Because our current will is actually saying, no, I've got to do some things. I want to do some things. Like I want to eat. I want to sleep. You know?
Right. Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So then if I exercise my faith to do nothing and I really try to do nothing, how long would you last?
Not very long.
Not very long. You wouldn't drink, so, you know, how long do we last without water?
About 7 days.
A few days. Mm. So you'd at least have to have the desire to drink to survive, wouldn't you, for at least more than a few days. How long can you survive without food? Well, that depends upon body store, fats and whatever else. But at the end of the day, a few months and you're pretty much stuffed, don't you?
Would that apply to your spirituality as well? If you choose to do nothing spiritually, would you...
Of course, if my will is currently set to do nothing spiritually, in other words, remember, spiritually is all about love. So my will is about, I'm not going to do anything about love. I'm just going to get my addictions met, act in my fears. That's all I'm going to do. And my desire is pretty much the same, then of course no change will be possible. But if I'm currently doing some loving things and then my desire is, and something happens to me and I go, I just don't believe in love anymore. Now what's going to happen to my soul condition? My desire is now saying, don't have anything to do with love.
It will degrade.
It will degrade. Mm. Mm-hmm. And many of you who have gotten angry from a previous relationship have degraded your soul as a result of that particular issue. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So don't fall into that trap, Shula. You've had some hard relationships. Don't fall into the trap of closing yourself down completely, because that is going to cause degradation of your soul. Yeah. Yep.
Thank you.
Teresa, next to you. Phil? Thank you. Teresa, next one. Thanks. This is question number two, Teresa, I'm looking at here. 23.
Okay. So if we only do things that we want to do, wouldn't that be a faster way of seeing that we are out of harmony with God, even if the thing is unloving, than someone who wants to do something but doesn't do it?
Yes. Interesting question. This is a question about how do I expose my real desires? And isn't it good if your real desires are exposed? Because then you know what the problem is. Yeah. But you've got to have an investigative attitude for it to work, don't you? Can you see that? Yeah. If you didn't have an investigative attitude, you would just go along with your unloving desires getting further and further degraded.
Yeah.
So if you have an investigative attitude, and remember, I think in the last group, Felix described when he did that. Like, he decided, yeah, I was going to get my addiction met. I don't really believe this old addiction thing. I'm going to get my addiction met, see what happens. But I'm going to measure the result. See, his desire was at least set to measure the result. Yep. Does that make sense? Because it was a bit pointless doing it and not measuring the result, because all that's going to result in is degradation without any change. Because you're desiring to not measure anything while still engaging unloving behaviour. So yes, but you're right. If we do things we want to do, that tells us a lot, right? Better than that, though, would be to feel the thing I want to do, and then be able to see, that's out of harmony with love. I don't have to do it to know it's out of harmony with love. I just have to feel it. That would be better again.
Okay.
To feel what you want to do that's out of harmony with love, notice it and go, okay, what is that the cause of that? And developing a desire to find the cause of that would be better again. Does that make sense? So, but what I see a lot of people doing is they're going, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do it. And I can feel from them, yes, you do. Mm. You're not even being honest. Not even being honest that that's what you want to do. You know, you want to get angry, or you want to punish somebody, or you want to be have retribution, you know, or whatever it is you're looking for. You can feel in people what they want a lot. Oftentimes, the more sensitive you become. And the very first part of change is really being honest, as we talked about in our first group, being honest about the truth. What is the truth of do I want it or not? Mm. Right? What is it that I want here? So facing up to the truth is very important as well. So, but the question, which is, if we only do things we want to do, wouldn't that be a faster way of seeing if we are out of harmony with God? Yes, it is a faster way, but there are even faster ways, is what I'm saying to you. So that's a faster way than just saying you want to do something when you really don't, or
not saying,
not doing what you really want.
Yeah.
Both of those things are slower ways, but a better way than that would be to actually go, I feel like I want to do that, but instead of doing it, I'm going to look at why I feel like I want to do it. That would be a better way. So as with most of these things, there's degrees of what is good to do that is more helpful than other things. So my suggestion is probably not do it that way still. Do it the feeling way.
Yeah.
That would be my suggestion, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, Lena, you're the last one on the list, Lena. Yep, but somebody needs to give Lena a microphone too. So one of the two of you needs to give her a microphone. Looking in confusion. She's right in the middle there. Yeah? She's the one you pass by ignoring that she's even there. Yeah.
I don't understand how my soul condition can have a different will from a desire.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't understand how my will can be different
from desire.
From a desire altogether. I don't understand.
Yeah, so I feel this is still a bit of a problem. The reason why I've asked Lena's question last is I do feel this is a bit of a problem still for many of you to understand the differences between the will and the desire, right? So if we go back to our definition, will is the current soul-based emotional condition. So this is very important to get, that will is what I am right now, warts and all. That's my will, right? It has a certain set of beliefs that I have right now. It has a certain set of emotions that I have right now. You could also say it has attitudes that, if you like. It has a certain, not character in the form of nature, but it has a certain character in the form of whether it's moral or not moral. So you could say it has a certain set of ethics, and it has a certain morality right now. Right, these are things that are my will right now. And you can see that there are many thousands of things that that might entail, right? Just thousands and thousands of different ideas, concepts, beliefs. It also is based upon my memories, as we said in a previous discussion. So even based on what you remember. Now, memories form two types of memories. Some are thoughts and some are feelings. So some of the memories you have are feeling-based memories but no thought with them, and some of the memories you have are thoughts but you hardly have any feelings associated with them. But they, of course, still determine what you're going to do right now. Make sense? Right. So that's my condition right now. So you could call that's the sum total of what we've been calling, that you've heard in the past, my soul condition, right? So there's my soul condition. My soul condition is my will. It determines what I'm going to do right now automatically, right? But it doesn't determine my future. That's the beauty. It doesn't determine my future. So this is my state now. And this is what I have faith in with regard to my future. Does that make sense? Now, my desires can also be the sum total of all these things. I could desire to have a different belief system. I could desire to have some different emotions. I can desire to have some different attitudes. I can desire a different morality. I can desire to engage more ethically. I can desire to remember things or not remember things. My desire, can you see, is something that I will finish up doing in the future. Now, the only difference is I have to have faith in that future in order for my desire to be activated. And that's why we've called the desire principles, have I got them here? The desire principles is a genuine expression of current soul-based faith. So my desire is what I currently have faith in, which is different to what you currently are. Does that make sense? So one's what you currently have faith in for your future, and it has to be, remember, it still has to be a feeling-based faith. It can't be just a concept or a head-based idea or something. It has to be something that you really believe and what's going to happen in the future. Now, what I'm saying is that if the will and desire are in harmony, what that means is that I currently have this set of beliefs, emotions, attitudes, ethics, and morality, and I have no faith that any of those should change or can change or will change. That's how we don't change. Does that make sense? Yep. Thanks. Okay, Gabby?
So,
you need to use mine.
So what you're saying is if your will and desire are at the same level mathematically, you're at zero base. You're not moving, like you're stagnant.
You won't move, yes.
Yeah, so like if zero is immovable and stagnating,
correct.
You're not degrading or,
no, and
evolving.
Correct, yeah, but given the fact that it's very hard for the soul to never change,
no.
Given the fact there's a lot of instinctual things, then can you see usually you either are improving or degrading?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's very hard for the soul just to say, identical year after year after year after year. Very difficult because there's always things that happen. Remember, the law of attraction is such that my will, this thing, attracts a whole lot of events telling me that there's something wrong with my will. So at some point, you're going to go wise up to it and go, oh, maybe there's something wrong with my will. And then from that moment on, you've now got a smidge of a desire to change that. So it's very, very difficult. And in fact, physically and emotionally and spiritually impossible for your will and desire to remain identical forever.
Right.
God's because, actually made it physically impossible.
Yeah.
Which is great, hey?
Yeah.
Because if he'd made it possible, then most of us probably stay there.
Yeah.
Okay, if we go across to Julie, thanks.
So where does repentance come in? Does it come in from your desire?
Anything that's good comes from your desire.
So repentance is part. So it can then grow your will through.
Yeah. By the way, anything that's bad comes from your desire too. Is that not true?
Yes.
Yeah. You can see that anything that moves you from your current position, whether it's in a position of degradation or a position of improvement, has to come from the fact that your desire is different to what your will is. Has to. So it can move you in a negative as well as a positive direction. Don't think it's all desire is going to take me in a positive direction. No, if you desire to murder someone, eventually you may be given to do it at some point, right? Yeah. And even just the desire is going to be leading you down to certain feelings and certain emotions and certain belief systems, is it not? So, Lena, does that... You haven't got the mic anymore with you. That sort of helps with... You can see one is the faith, the real faith that we have in a future state. And the other is what we have right now. And that's the secret to understanding the difference between will and desire. To understand that we can change this without yet even changing this. In fact, this will not change unless we change this. Now, God's laws, God's principles, the will and desire principles, remember, interact with all the laws we've talked about thus far. So they interact and cause us to go, oh, maybe there's something wrong with my will. And once we know there's something wrong with my will, I can go, do I want to change that or not? There's desire. So me just asking the question, do I want to change it, is a shift in my desire. Of course, you would need more than that to actually change, won't you? You need to take that through experimentation and so forth to change. So hopefully, we're 5 minutes over, guys, so I have to stop it there, unfortunately. But isn't it a fascinating discussion? Yeah. You find that fascinating? How will and desire work in harmony with each other, and how God's put the measurement of your will and the measurement of your desire inside of every law. Mathematical, scientific certainty from God's perspective. He measures every single desire. And it's very hard, in fact, for two people to have identical desires on identical things with the identical measurement, because it's like any measurement system, there's always little variable factors, right? So even your personality can be a variable factor in the way in which you express desire. So you know, God's measuring each little tiny thing, exact down to the exact feeling, and then the law responds. And isn't it wonderful the law responds? Imagine a universe where you had a positive desire and the law just goes. And you have a negative desire and the law just goes. In other words, the law just goes nothing. No, you know, whatever you do doesn't matter. You know what you'd finish up believing? Nothing matters. And isn't that what many of you, unfortunately, have believed in the past, that nothing matters? Nothing matters. But and many people on the planet, unfortunately, believe that. But that's because we've lived in this human environment not seeing that everything matters. Everything matters. And God desired to create a universe where you came to the conclusion that everything matters. This is a wonderful creation, actually. He's informing us that what you do, what you say, even what you think and feel matters to the universe around you. Isn't that fantastic? It all matters. And every feeling you have matters. Every thought you have matters. And you'll find in your transformation side of things, man, that is a very powerful thing to engage. If you know that everything matters, then you can start determining what's going to matter to you. Yeah, what's going to be important to you. Anyway, we'll leave it there. So our next discussion is obviously about God's authority. So what we're going to do now is have a 10-minute break. I'm running about 8 minutes late. So if we can come past about 18 past three, and we'll get on to the subject of God's authority. Thanks, guys.